So let's step back for a moment and look at how things operate today. Effectively, every member of the business network has their own copy of the ledger. And we're showing this here in different colors around the different members of the business network. And as I mentioned previously, the ledger's updated every time an asset flows into the organization or goes out of the organization. Each member of the business network who's affected updates their ledger. This system's been around since the 13th century. Effectively, we've been incrementally digitizing a system that's basically centuries old. The good side of that is it's pretty well tried and tested, and it's in popular usage. The downside of it is it's inefficient, it's expensive, and it's vulnerable. Now, what do I mean by that? Inefficient means that each of the different parties in the business network need to run their own form of the business process to update their ledger. Effectively, they're doing that in a duplicative way. It's expensive in that if you were to do things like internal and external audit, it takes an awful lot of time and effort to do that across the business network. Some banks have told us that some 20% of their time is actually spent in the internal and external audit function because it's so complicated across the business network. And it's also vulnerable, and it's vulnerable to either fraud, a malicious modification of the ledger, or to cyber attack or cyber incident. Or simple mistakes are actually very difficult to render should they get into the business network. So as I say, this is before blockchain comes along. If we bring blockchain into the picture, we have the situation where all of the members of the business network share a common ledger on the blockchain. And the ledger is replicated through peer-to-peer replication technologies across all the different members of this business network. But we actually use privacy services to determine who can see what on the business network. So for example, if participant A was actually exchanging an asset with participant B, each of these members would be able to see the full details of that transaction. However, the bank, if it was not involved in that transaction, wouldn't be able to see the details. But how? And alternatively, if participant A was transferring something with the bank, those two counterparties would be able to see the full details of the transaction, and participant B wouldn't. This is all controlled, as I say, by privacy services. When we overlay blockchain onto this network, we end up with these really four important points at the bottom of the slide. Consensus means that we determine who within the business network gets to validate or approve a transaction. This is encoded into the blockchain system. We also, we actually engender through the use of blockchain the concept of provenance. Now, this is effectively an audit trail, a complete record of who's owned what asset throughout its life cycle. This is all recorded on the blockchain. And again, because we use privacy services to link one block in the blockchain with the next block, this means that it's impossible to tamper with the blocks once they're actually written, which gives us the property of immutability, thus effectively boosting trust across the business network. And the final thing is, last but not least, is finality. And this comes really as a consequence of all the previous three. And it means that once something's committed into the blockchain, we've got one single system of record, one single system of truth across the business network, which can effectively assure that disputes are very easy to resolve should they occur.